Hello friends, welcome to VAVAIS. Welcome to the discussion on Vision Economy PT365, and this is part 15 of the lecture series where we are going to discuss the infrastructure sector, which is the 8th topic, right? Let's begin. So the first one in the infrastructure sector, what we have is the recent infrastructural initiatives of India. And in that, the first one, what we have is the National Infrastructure Pipeline. So this National Infrastructure Pipeline, if you see, this is basically a fund which was created for the investments in the infrastructure sector. Recently, Finance Minister has launched this online dashboard for the National Infrastructure Pipeline for all the stakeholders for the information on the infrastructure projects. Okay? And this dashboard is on the Indian Infrastructure Grid, which is an interactive online platform, which shows the real-time data of all the investments and everything. Because see, why this fund was created is, India is in need of a lot of money for the infrastructure. The infrastructure growth is very much necessary for the development of India. Only if infrastructure grows, India is going to see the growth that India, that we actually need. Because we are a growing nation, we need more of urbanization, right? And it is expected that by 2040, the number of cities will dramatically increase. So for that, we need infrastructure. And also, we need social infrastructure. We need the roads. Okay, we need more of good quality highways, good quality metro rails, everything. So for that also, we need more money. And also for the economic growth, as I told already, if India wants to grow, it is this infrastructure which is going to take India forward. So infrastructure is that much important. And another thing, if you see, these days we are facing this challenge of climate change and disaster vulnerability. So for all this, we need high quality infrastructure in order to mitigate all of these challenges. And also, we need manufacturing industry. And for the manufacturing industry to grow, we need logistics and everything to be more efficient. And for that, we need high quality infrastructure in the country for the faster movement of goods and everything. So for that also, we need infrastructure. So, you know, so keeping in mind all of these things, the government has launched this National Infrastructure Pipeline. So here it is given, India should spend about 4.5 trillion on infrastructure by 2030 to sustain its growth rate. And the government has announced already 102 lakh crores to be implemented by 2025. So it's a huge investment what the government is doing. So India is trying to boost its growth through the infrastructural investment. All the capital investment which the government will be doing, and most of it will go to this infrastructure sector itself. To draw the NIP, all economic and social infrastructure projects are harmonized master list were taken up and identified. That's the thing. Okay? So here the trend is given. So if you see the trend, there is no linear trend with respect to this. Till 2018, the investment has increased. But after that, it has decreased in 2019. So there is no linear trend. So if tomorrow in exam, there is a question, India is continuously increasing its investment, or India is seeing a continuous growth rate in investment in the infrastructure, then that will be a wrong statement, because there are ups and downs in this data. Okay? So the next one is the constituents of National Infrastructure Pipeline. What are the things that are involved? So economic and social infrastructure projects, right? So the projects which are important for the economy, and the projects which are important for the social aspects also, the social infrastructure, like the housing and everything. And projects which are greater than 100 crore, the greenfield projects. So greenfield project means projects which have to be started from the scratch. Okay, that is called as greenfield project. And brownfield project are the ones which are already in progress, or something which need to be redeveloped. Isko bolte brownfield projects. Okay, and there are projects under conceptualization as well. So here in this figure, the sector wise share is given. The energy sector is the major sector, you can see over here like that. So on which sector how much spending is done, the pie chart is given. Okay, right. So the next topic what we have is the National Program and Project Management Policy Framework, NPM PF. So this is by Niti Aayog and the Quality Council of India. Remember, the National Program and Project Management Policy Framework is by Niti Aayog and the Quality Council of India, and they want radical reforms in the infrastructural project execution. Because if you see, Indian infrastructure is facing a lot of challenges. Any construction is facing a lot of challenges. First, the challenges with the clearances. Okay, so first, there are challenges there with the clearances. Before clearances, we have another challenge called the land acquisition. This is another major challenge. Okay, even if the clearances they have got for the project and the land is acquired, after that, they face this issue of governance. There will be some more the other hurdles. and after that they might face some issue of raw materials as well. They will not get what they want, and also the capital machinery, that is also a problem. So all of these problems are there, okay, and also the waste management issues, and also money is one of the main issue, the capital, that is another main issue. So all of these issues are there. So you know, to ensure that all of these issues get reduced and to develop good infrastructure, radical reforms are needed in this execution of the projects especially. So this NPMPF, basically it helps in developing good quality infrastructure, robust governance, reducing costs and waste material without compromising on environment and ecology. So everything is taken care of, all the factors are taken care of by this national program itself. And it forms a crucial link between the project portfolios and the strategic disciplines to ensure smooth execution. That means project planning and project execution, these are two different things. So during the planning stage and during the permission stage and everything, this national program will play a huge role. And India requires about 4.5 trillion by 2040 to develop the infrastructure for the economic growth to sustain. So that's why infrastructure is very important. So this NPMPF, it provides action plan to program and manage project for the infrastructure development, institutionalize and promote profession of program and project management, and build workforce of professionals. Third one, enhance institutional capacity or capability of the professionals. These three are there. It means they will be managing projects, they will be developing skills in the people with regard to project management and everything. And third one, they will also enhance the institutional capacity of the professionals. That means enhance the capacity of the professionals, capabilities, everything will be enhanced. So these are the major things. Okay, so this is the information about National Program and Project Management Framework, NPMPF. Right. Next one is the logistics sector. So this logistics sector, if you see, this is very important for the development of manufacturing sector. The logistics sector is also important because it contributes a lot of money to the GDP. So it contributes a lot to the GDP. But high logistics cost is one thing that is impeding the development of manufacturing industry. So approximately, if you see, 13 to 14% of GDP, of the manufacturing GDP, goes to the logistic cost itself, which is a very huge thing. Because normally, globally, it is just 7 to 8%. So we have to reduce the logistic cost. The logistic cost is because of a lot of reasons. We don't have well-developed railway connecting all the cities, especially for the freight. We don't have fast-moving roads, the express highways, we don't have a lot of them. We don't have inland shipping. Inland shipping is not there because inland shipping is one of the cheapest modes of transportation. So as all of these issues are there, we are facing, or you can say, we are not able to develop our manufacturing system and we are not able to make it more competitive. So recently, India's first ever multi-modal logistic park is set to be set up in Jogegopa in Assam. Remember, Jogegopa in Assam, India's first multi-modal logistic park. So remember this. Okay. Now, what is this multi-modal logistic park? So here in this image, you can see, let's say in Mumbai, there is a multi-modal logistic park. Okay. And they have to transfer the goods to Delhi. Let's say there are 10 trucks. Normally, what used to happen is these 10 trucks will travel to Delhi separately. These 10 trucks, which carry different types of goods, they will travel from Mumbai to Delhi because Mumbai is a port city. And from Mumbai, they will travel to Delhi. This is how it used to happen. But now with this multimodal park, what will happen is that these 10 trucks, they will come to this park. They will come to this park. And here in this park, what will happen is they will actually combine all the goods. They will combine all the goods. Okay, all the 10 trucks, they will be combined. And yeah, here it is given example of 3 trucks. Okay, 3 10-ton trucks. So these 3 10-ton trucks will be transferred to a single 30-ton truck. And it will be transferred to Delhi. Or else, what they will do is, they will transfer the goods of these 10-ton trucks either through rail or inland waterway, and they will transfer to Delhi. So here what is happening? They are able to save money. They are able to save transport cost. And also, they will be moving the goods faster. Because normally, on the road, it takes a lot of time. It takes a lot of time, and also 10 trucks, if they have to move, the roads become congested, and also they will take more time. So they are reducing all of these things. Okay. Now, all the goods will reach to the Delhi logistic park, and from this logistic park, again, they will be transferred to the 10-ton trucks, and they will directly take the goods to the companies which have ordered them. ठीक है. सो दिस इज द कॉन्सेप्ट ऑफ दिस मल्टी मॉडल लॉजिस्टिक पार्क. ठीक है. सो दिस इज द की पॉलिसी इनिशिएटिव ऑफ द गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया टू इम्प्रूव द कंट्रीज लॉजिस्टिक सेक्टर ओवरऑल. एंड द मेन एम यू कैन से इट इज टू रिड्यूस द फ्राइट कॉस्ट. ओके. एंड ऑल्सो रिड्यूस व्हीकलर पोल्यूशन. दिस इज अनदर इंपॉर्टेंट थिंग. सी इफ 10 ट्रक्स आर गोइंग दैट मीन्स द पोल्यूशन विल बी हाई. ओके. बट इफ दे आर ट्रांसफर टू एदर रेल और शिप और इफ दे आर ट्रांसफर टू अ सिंगल ट्रक देन वॉट इज गोइंग टू हैपन. द पोल्यूशन इज ऑल्सो गोइंग टू रिड्यूस एंड ऑल्सो वेयर हाउसिंग कॉस्ट विल रिड्यूस. ठीक है. सो दिस इज द इंपॉर्टेंट थिंग. नाउ या हियर इट इज गिवन. दिस प्रोजेक्ट इज लॉन्च इन 2017. दिस मल्टी मॉडल प्रोजेक्ट एंड रिमेंबर इट इज पार्ट ऑफ द भारतमाला परियोजना. भारतमाला परियोजना दैट मीन्स भारतमाला प्रोजेक्ट विच इज लॉन्च्ड टू डेवलप द रोड इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर. And the project was launched in 2017 to develop 35 MMLPs, that is a multi-modal logistic park. And the first one is going to be set up at Jogigopain, Assam. Remember Jogigopain, Assam, right? And some of the reasons for high logistic cost of India, here it is given. 60% freight is by road. 60% freight is by road, remember. So like you can observe what is the why we are actually facing all of these issues. Because of this we are facing pollution issues, because of this we are facing cost issues, everything. And underdeveloped material handling infrastructure. The material handling infrastructure actually is very much important. For example, the large cranes, okay, and also the warehouses. So these come under this material handling infrastructure. And also the procedural complexities of the toll collection and interstate freight. Now with the introduction of GST, this has become better, but still we face issues because regular checkups will be there at the near the toll gates and everything. All the interstate movement of goods, they will be checked, the goods will be checked and everything, which takes a lot of time in fact. And these MMLPs, the multimodal logistic parks, can provide infrastructure for the seamless transfer, warehouses and specialist storage facilities, value added services like custom clearance, quarantine zones, testing facilities, warehouse management, etc. So with this, the overall logistics cost will decrease and this will become an example, or you can say this will boost the manufacturing facilities in India. Okay. And the proposed Jogigopa, this multimodal terminal, it will connect Brahmaputra river and also the inland waterway route will take off. Okay. So that's about this multimodal logistic park. And the next one is government is considering a new law to streamline the logistics sector. And Minister of Commerce will frame this law so that there will be seamless movement and also they can actually rationalize all the logistics sector. That is the main aim, so that the efficiency will increase and also the cost of the logistics will decrease. And this will replace the earlier multimodal transportation of goods act of 1993. With this law, the government aims to define the various participants of logistics space and also reduce the logistic cost, as I told already, from 14% of GDP to about 10% of GDP. Okay. And if you see, there is this index called the Logistic Performance Index. And remember, this is released by the World Bank. Logistic Performance Index released by World Bank. And currently India is ranked 44th. Right. So the next one is about roadways. So roadways was in news because recently we have even seen that India became one of the fastest road constructing nation. The number of kilometers of road per day, it has actually surpassed all the countries we have witnessed recently. And this almost all the credit can be given to our road minister, Mr. Nitin Gadkari. So what happened is earlier we used to construct road using a PPP model called the BOT model. BOT model, the build operate transfer, where this private entities, they will build. Okay, they will take the project, they will take care of all the permissions and everything. They will operate that road, let's say for example a road, they will operate that road for about 10 years. They will be responsible for all the toll collection and everything. And then they will transfer to the government. Okay, so this is the BOT model. Sorry, BOT model. But now in this, what is happening is the risk of permissions, the permission risk, the land acquisition risk, and also the risk related to collection, all of them only goes to the private entity. So this is becoming a major problem. And also the government policies change with time. The government policies change every 5 years after the government changes. So as all of these things are happening, it has not become remunerative, it has not become advantageous for the private players. So these BOT projects have failed, you can say. So earlier 96% of the projects which were awarded in 2011-12 that came under the, but in the last two fiscal years, actually this came down to zero. So the number of projects under BOT were reduced. So now the government is using various other PPP models like the EPC, engineer, procure and construct, and the hybrid annuity model. So all of these things are generally being used. Okay, now we will see what are these three in basic, with some more information. What are the BOT, EPC and hybrid annuity model? This BOT, if you see here, as I told already, the total permission has to be taken by this person who is constructing it, the private player. Okay, and also he only has to ensure all the funds for the project. There are three things. First is the permissions and the land. Okay, next one is funds. Next one is the toll collection for the highways, especially. These three are there. Okay, so in BOT, what will happen is the permissions, the funds, and the toll collection, all the things have to be taken care of by the private player only. So all the risk will be borne by him only. But if you see EPC, engineer, procure, and construct, here the permissions will be taken care of by the government itself. The permissions will be taken care by the government itself, and also the funds also will be provided by the government. The private player just simply has to construct it within the given time. And after that, he has to hand over to the government, and the government will take care of these toll collections as well, right? So the next one, what you have is the hybrid annuity model, HAM. This hybrid annuity model is combination of both BOT and EPC, you can say. It is combination of both. So here you can see the permissions and everything, all these things are taken care by the government. And it will be given to the private player. So here, when we come to funds, what will happen is 40% of funds will be given by the government. 40% will be given by the government, and rest 60%, it has to be raised by the private player from the market based on the value of the project, because already 40% the government is giving, and the government is actually telling this private player to construct. So as the construction will start, the project value will increase. So as the project value will increase, it will be very easy for the private player to get loans. So the government is using this type of a thing for the hybrid annuity model. Okay, for the first five years, the government will be paying about 40%. Okay, after that, it is this private player who has to take care of it, right? So this is about the hybrid annuity model, right? So now the government, NHAI, the National Highway Authority of India, it is shifting from this EPC to hybrid annuity models. Okay, because this hybrid annuity model, the risk is shared both by the government and the private player. The revenue risk, so here in this hybrid annuity model, the revenue will be collected, the toll will be collected by the government only. Okay, and the lump sum amount will be given to the private player. So the whole risk is borne by the government, the revenue collection risk especially. Okay, and the funds risk is shared by the government and private player, and also the permission risk, everything is shared by, or you can say it's taken by the government. It's not shared, it is taken by the government. Okay, so this is about these issues. So now here some information is given. So the key features of model concession agreement. So this model concession agreement, if you see, under this concession agreement only, okay, the projects will start. Now a model concession agreement was brought in. This is mainly to ensure that more and more liberal norms are provided for the private player. Okay, so that he will get a bit more advantage, because the private players are taking all the risk. So the revenue, so here the first one is revenue, so revised revenue assessment. Under it, 5 years during the concession period, revenue potential of the project is reassessed. Okay, that means after 5 years, the project revenue will be reassessed, and then if needed, the terms of the contract will vary. Because normally what will happen, sometimes these infrastructure projects are long term. Initially, before the start of project, they will fix for one rate. But after 5 years, the rates in the market will change, the rates in the economy will change. So when everything changes, you know, the terms has to be varied. Only then the private player will get some advantage. So this is now being done under this model concession agreement. And also land acquisition. Okay, this land acquisition is a major issue when we talk about any infrastructure project in India. The work order for the built highways project is issued when 90% of the land is acquired. That means only after acquiring the land, the work order will be issued. Otherwise, what is happening now? The project, they are starting the project, but land acquisition is not complete. So they are building this road up till halfway, and then they are leaving it. This is actually wasting time and money as well. So that's why they are doing this. and also it provides for setting up of dispute resolution board. Okay, and this is for the continuous dispute resolution mechanism, and it provides for timely redressal of their grievances within 90 days especially. This is a great step, because normally when there is an issue between government and the private player, or issue between anyone, what is going to happen? The important thing is the funds get locked up. The funds get locked up, and this is a huge trouble. And because of this only, the NPAs will be increasing, because the private players, they will be taking loan. So when the money got stuck up, when the money will get stuck up, then this issue will be faced. Okay, so there is another PPP model called the toll operate transfer. Okay, this toll operate transfer model, if you see, so this is also being used for the highway projects only, where the investor make lump sum payment in return for the long term toll collection and the for long term toll collection rights backed by sound tolling system. Okay, so here what will happen, the government will be constructing the road and everything. Okay, so the toll collection, okay, the toll collection, that will be that order will be, or you can say the toll collection responsibility will be given to a private player for a lump sum amount. So in this way, the government will not have any headache for collecting tolls, and there is no need for the government to maintain all of these things. Okay, so they will take money from the private player, a lump sum amount, let's say for 20 years or 30 years, and then they will give award this contract to the private player. Okay, so the highest bidder will win the right to operate and maintain the road asset for about 30 years, with the right to toll collection from these assets until then. Okay, so this is a very attractive model for the investors, as there is no need for them to build any infrastructure project. They will not take any risk in construction and taking permissions, but they will share the risk of revenue. So this is also a type of PPP model. Okay, so the next one. So the next one is the motor vehicle aggregator guidelines were launched. So these aggregators, if you see, aggregators are basically the platforms where the car, you can say, so this is a platform actually connects the aggregators are the platforms which connect car driver and the hirer, in simple words. Okay, so that means it's just an intermediary platform where the hirer, that means we, the customer, okay, can meet the car driver. This is the aggregator, means that means, for example, Uber, Ola, Meru, etc. These are the aggregators. Okay, so recently motor vehicle aggregator guidelines were announced by the Ministry of Road Transport and Highways, and some of the guidelines, if you see, the license will be issued by state, and it is mandatory for the permitting of business. For the business to carry on, this has to be taken, and regulating the aggregators, so the rules will be framed by both the government of India as well as the state government. So the main rules will be framed by the government of India, and some of the sub rules will be framed by the state governments as well. Okay, and if you see the regulatory framework for the aggregators, okay, this will be given by the state government, so that these aggregators, they are responsible and accountable to the state government directly for their operations. Because sometimes what is happening, they are not taking responsibility for any act committed under their platform, under their watch. So now they have to take accountability for the actions. And also the proposed guidelines to ensure regulation of aggregator app or website, fair regulation, driver welfare, etc. So for this also some guidelines were announced. Okay, and the objective is, if you see the overall objectives, the overall main objective is to share the, is to at least ensure that these aggregators have some responsibility for the things that are being committed. If you see, for example, Twitter currently, so it just won't follow the government laws, and also it says that it will not take responsibility for any act committed under it, which is a bad thing. This is not in line how a company should function. If a company is doing its business, then the important thing is that it should do everything under the ambit of law. No one is above law, no one is below law. Everyone is equal in front of the law. So, okay, so that's how it has to be. So that's why these are announced. Okay, and also this is mainly to ensure the ease of doing business, customer safety and driver welfare. These are the important aspects of it. Okay, so this is about the motor vehicle aggregator guidelines. So next one is about the National Highway Authority of India. So recently, National Highway Authority of India has filed application with SEBI as it plans 19 projects worth 35,000 crores under the Infrastructure Investment Model. So Infrastructure Investment Trust model. Now, what is this Infrastructure Investment Trust, InvITs? So these InvITs are basically something like a mutual fund. They are something like a mutual fund where the investors, this infrastructure investment trust, what it will do is it will go to the stock exchange. Okay, it will go to the stock exchange and it will release bonds. And these bonds, that means these shares, you can say, not bonds also, these shares will be purchased by the investors, simply like that of the mutual funds. It will be purchased by the investors, and this infrastructure investment trust will use to invest in the infrastructure projects. That is the key thing. Okay, that is the key thing. So here it is given. So recently the union's cabinet in 2019, they have approved this infrastructure investment trust by the National Highway Authority of India. So what will happen is that this will be established under the Indian Trust Act of 1882, and it will comply all the rules of SEBI. Okay, so that's why taking permission from the SEBI is very important for this investment trust also, because they also in some aspects they will be similar to that of mutual funds. Okay, and if you see these infrastructure investment trust, okay, so here individuals will be investing, and also the returns will be given to the individuals directly. And this National Highway Authority of India, if you see, it is a statutory body which is constituted by the Act of Parliament in 1988, and it became operational in 1995. Okay, and this NHA consists of full-time chairman and not more than 5 full-time members and 4 part-time members, so total of 10 members who are appointed by the Government of India. And next important thing is this data lake and project management software. This is launched by NHAI, the National Highway Authority of India. Remember, data lake and project management software by National Highway Authority of India. It's a cloud-based artificial intelligence powered big data analytics platform. That is the important thing. Next one, the National Highway Authority of India, first construction sector organization to go fully digital. So this is the important thing. This is the first construction sector organization to go fully digital, and basically what they are trying to do is they are trying to remove paperwork, because normally, because of the documentation and paperwork, what is happening is, first of all, the paper gets wasted. That is a small thing, but beyond that, what is happening is sometimes the documents get missed. Sometimes what will happen, there will be delay in the decision making because the papers will be reaching late. So in order to remove all of these things, in order to remove all of these inefficiencies, this cloud-based project was launched. So the project documentation, contractual decisions and approvals, all of these things are done through portal only. And this will ensure that there are no delays, that the decision making becomes quick, and also there is no question of missing records. This is the important thing. Okay, the missing records will not get missed, and the work can be done anywhere. Like, there is no need for a person to sit somewhere in Delhi or anywhere to take the permission or something like that. A person who is in the project site can directly send the request to the person in Delhi for the permission. And this will also enhance the transparency in the system. This is the important thing. With any e-governance project, with any Digital India project, the important thing is you will have ARC, accountability, okay, sorry, accountability, this is T, sorry, accountability, responsibility and transparency. All these three will be there with any project, okay, ART. So that's it, friends, for this lecture. I'll see you again in the next lecture. Okay, we'll continue with this infrastructure and we'll finish in the next lecture. Okay, and we'll finish this economy also very soon. And these are our initiatives, guys. Vision Prelims Test Series, Vision PT 365, Vision Mains Test Series, and Vision Monthly Magazine. So we have summarized all of these things. We have summarized 100 pages, this Vision Economy PT 365, into just 50 pages. Okay, so we have done this to ensure that you will be able to revise things multiple times so that your preparation becomes easy and more effective. This is what is our aim as well. So do follow our initiatives, do subscribe to our YouTube channel, and share the word about WAVIS. Thank you, and I'll see you again. Jai Hind.